गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ओम गणानान्त्वा गणपतिगुं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पत आनश्रुण्वन्नोतिभिः सीदसादनं श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः सदाशिवसमारम्भां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् आत्मस्वरूप
टेक मेडिटेशन वेरी सीरियसली. आई एम नॉट सजेस्टिंग दैट यू कंटिन्यू टू सिट इन मेडिटेशन फॉर अवर्स टुगेदर. दैट काइंड ऑफ थिंग आई एम नॉट सजेस्टिंग. दो इट इज नेसेसरी टू स्पेंड सर्टन अमाउंट ऑफ टाइम इन मेडिटेशन. इट इज नेसेसरी. देर विल बी ओनली वन मेडिटेशन क्लास पर डे. That is morning 7 to 7:30. Just I will take only 30 minutes because it's very optimum. Any prolonging it further will not help in depth. The mind gets dispersed and all that. So I'm not going to make it 40 minutes or even 35 minutes. The best time, generally I do 32 minutes like that. It goes sometimes. Sometimes it may end in 30 minutes itself. So that is the meditation session. But we should acquire depth in meditation. It comes in the session itself, there will be depth in meditation, I am sure. You should acquire a few things with reference to meditation. All the wisdom that we try to gather from these glorious texts, that should reflect in our life. And the gulf between the life and this light, life and light. There is a gulf. And the only way to bridge that gulf is meditation. There is no other way. Meditation is the one which bridges the gulf between belief and behavior. You believe something and you behave something else. So you know something and you do something else. So that gulf, it is there in our lives. We have to bridge it. And it is nididhyasanam, which is otherwise called meditation in a given context. Meditation or contemplation, whatever. So that is very important. And meditation doesn't mean just sitting half an hour in a particular sattvic effort. Meditation is a sattvic activity of the mind. So we do that. That is part of our training. But that alone is not meditation. You should be meditative throughout the day. And so I would request you to convert this camp as a training ground for meditation. Take it. I'm not suggesting that you become stiff and grim and all that. I'm not suggesting that. But I suggest you take it with all earnestness and all eagerness and pay lot of attention to this thing called meditation. We should adopt a meditative lifestyle. How? I tell you, the best way to do it is, we talk less. It should begin with that maunam. Maunavyakhya, I tell you. Silence. Silence of the mind is the greatest truth. Hyperactivity of the mind, mind engaging itself, subject after subject, one subject after another, jumping from one thought pattern to another thought pattern, engaging in one emotion after another, one discussion after another. So, engaging the mind like that, incessantly, it is exactly the opposite of meditation. So, and the depth in meditation won't come like that. That half an hour, you will gain depth in it, and that depth will bring some radical transformation within, provided you make it happen by leading the rest of the life's time, the day's time, in a very conducive fashion. It must be conducive to meditation. So talking is less. It is very essential. Sadhakas do not talk much. I have a feeling that we end up, at the end of the day, we have talked more than necessary. Go on talking and talking and talking. And I think it makes our whole effort very loose and listless and superficial. We should be cheerful. Cheerfulness is not talkativeness. It is not uproariousness. That is not what it is. We should be cheerful. So, anyway, I am not trying to give any moral lecture or any such thing. I am not say anything against anything. But I suggest we talk less. I am not going to the extent of saying you maintain maunam all through the day. I am not saying it. Even if you do it, nothing wrong, I tell you. It could be a glorious thing too. But I am not saying that. We talk less. We talk purposefully. Suppose the other person wants to talk with me and I keep maunam. I have not given regard to the other person's feeling. I have not given due respect to the other person's feeling. So I don't want to do that. If the other person wants to talk with me, I would say, sir, are you planning to say something? Please go ahead and say. I do not stand on maunam and all that. Because respecting the other person's wish is more important than maunam. And after talking with the other person, then my maunam will be there with me. Nobody can take away from me. You cannot take away my maunam. I will follow my maunam. If you talk with me for 3 minutes and you move on, my maunam is not disturbed. My maunam will continue. Maunam is silence. So I would request you to consider to follow silence as part of sadhana. Taking lesson is important, but living a few values now, not later. Later you will do whatever you have to do. Now, part of the camp, we live a few values, the maunam. But maunam is not a grim face. Maunam is a smile always. There is a smile on the face. There is cheerfulness, ready to respond to the other person's query any time. In fact, I will say, if you are doing japam, you are in the middle of the mala, if the other person needs a little help from you or guidance from you, you need to speak to the other person, keep the mala aside and talk with him. I would go to that extent. Because talking with the other person and respecting him, there is atma in his heart, which is not different from this atma. So, Ishvara is in every heart. So that respecting that person is a better worship than completing the mala. Therefore, maunam is there. Talking must be purposeful. It should be for the benefit of the other person, not because there is nothing else to do. We are free anyway. Therefore, just to spend the time, or as a kind of a fillers, they say fillers. Between the classes, some filling must be required for the mind, you know. So as a filler, we use talking. So we may avoid it. You pursue maunam. It requires initially some effort and some training. One has to train oneself. Nobody will train us. We have to train ourselves. For you, for me, it is common for all. And so you may just read in between any book, any paper. In fact, it is always better to plan some reading also. So what is it that we are going to read? So one book is fixed and so one you will have some marker there and it will be sitting there and we read it. Reading could be fill the gaps in between, the time gaps. Purposeful talking and helping others or whatever, that could fill the gaps in between. And sometimes even meditation could fill the gaps in between, if you can. I will introduce a kind of meditation which could be used to fill the gaps in between, if any. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, you can fill that gap with some small meditation for yourself. The meditation need not be only between 7 and 7:30. It could be any time in between. I'm not suggesting when there are half a dozen people, suddenly you go into a trance. Not that way. As appropriate as possible, whichever is convenient to you. So convert the whole camp into a camp of meditation, learning and meditation, learning and meditation, learning and meditation. Please do that way. Now, coming to the meditation. I will give you a broad outline of the meditation scheme that we are going to follow. The first and the most important step of meditation is asana. Don't think that asana is outside meditation. Asana is the sitting posture. Meditation begins with it. You are in the sitting posture, already you are in meditation. That is when it begins. So my point is, don't dissociate asana from meditation. Integrate asana into meditation. Very important. That is how the vision of Patanjali is. Then comes Deha Vikshanam. Deha Vikshanam means abiding as the witnessing awareness with reference to the physical body. This has to be practiced non-stop. For all the days we are in the camp, we'll practice it. It will be 3 to 4 minutes as part of the meditation. Because in assimilating the truth of the teaching of Vedanta, the main obstacle is body identification. And so we have to work overtime to neutralize that. Overtime I mean, so daily we look at that aspect. I bring in always some novelty into it as far as possible, but it will be there. Asana, Dehavikshana. Maybe 3 minutes, 3 minutes like that it will be there every day, beginning of the meditation. Then comes, in that order, prana vikshana. Not pranayama. Not pranayama. Pranayama is easier than prana vikshana. Pranayama has got a method, a structure, and it is a discipline. Vikshana.
What is the word, Swamiji? Vikshana?
Vikshana means witnessing. Witnessing. Neutral, uninvolved. You do not involve in it. That way you have to witness. I will tell you. We will do all that in meditation. Whereas in pranayama, it is not witnessing. You command the prana, the breath, you command it. You do it in a particular way. The way you want to do it, you do it. You exert the will in pranayama. So that the breathing happens in a fixed pattern as indicated by the yoga. It is yoga breathing technique it is. Whereas in pranavikshanam, you do not exert any will whatsoever. You will remain a totally neutral witness and watch the prana. This is much more difficult than pranayama, because in pranayama you have a structure to follow. And so mind loves a structure. Mind doesn't like open-endedness. It wants to tie up everything and fix everything in a category and pigeonhole, and then only it gets satisfied. That is how mind functions. Whereas in pranavikshanam, you will try to train the mind not to involve, except being the witness. In the process, mind resolves. And I once again say, pranavikshanam is more difficult than pranayama. And I can teach a student pranayama in 3 days. But pranavikshanam, you have to practice even more than a month to get any grip over it. It is a slow process, very fulfilling process, and it brings the transformation within the person in a slow and steady fashion. All real transformation is always slow. You please take it as a rule. All real transformation is slow. Any dramatic change will be only short-lived. It will not be there after a while. Like weight loss. What you lose slowly, you really lose. Any dramatic weight loss will come back. Therefore, this is the panacea, I mean this Ramabanam-like thing, for bringing steady transformation of the personality. And after a while of pranavikshanam, vairagya you will get automatically, equipoise of the mind, samatvam. So all those things become very natural to the person.
Swamiji, what is the main distinction between the two? One is you are witnessing the body, the other one is...
Witnessing the prana, witnessing the breath. Witnessing the prana. So I will be introducing it tomorrow itself, and I plan to do it at least for 6-7 days, and then give a break. From my side, you will continue to do it in your spare time.
Vikshana?
We seeing. Like Deha Vikshana, Prana Vikshana. Then comes Pranayama. You will do Pranayama. This is easy stuff. You have done earlier also, and you will do now also. I don't mean this is less important. But relatively easy to do. So, in pranayama, I will introduce sectional breathing, means the entire breathing apparatus will be divided into three parts, the abdomen, the chest, and the collarbones. That is the breathing apparatus. So the chest, the abdomen will be connected with the lower part of the lungs, chest with the middle portion, the collarbone and shoulders, they are connected to the upper lobe of the lungs. So the three parts. And so we practice some breathing with reference to these three parts. It is called sectional breathing. That prepares the breathing apparatus for some good, lasting, sustained pranayama. So I will do that. Maybe 5-6 days, so that it better to prepare well, you know. Then I will do anuloma viloma. Means inhaling, exhaling, guided, you guide it, not witnessing or any such thing. Just you do it in a particular way. You enforce your will in inhaling and exhaling. Then I will do single nostril breathing. We close one nostril and do with the second, only one nostril. I sincerely feel that this is very tough. Tough means doing is okay, but that prana, as you practice, initially it is very gross, but as you continue to practice it, it becomes very subtle, and you gain the depth in it. And anybody who can practice single nostril breathing every day, 10-15 minutes morning and evening, his prana structure, it will be, all his BP is just gone. He cannot have any BP anymore. It will not be possible to retain BP. So single nostril breathing has got very many advantages. It helps the physical health. It is very powerful. But it is tough in the sense that you have to practice it. You see, you have to, these things like pranavikshana, these things, you have to practice them anywhere between 5 to 6 months. Then you gain some depth in it. They look very simple, but don't be deceived by the simplicity. One has to practice with love. You have to befriend meditation, I tell you. You cannot keep meditation as an enforced boredom. You have to befriend it. You should love it. A stage comes when you love to meditate. You are sitting in between four people, there's some discussion is going on. You suddenly feel like getting up and going to the room and do meditation. That kind of you befriend meditation. From this moment onwards, you befriend it. It's only just tuning the mind. Befriend it. Don't look at it as an exercise, an effort, an enforced discipline. Don't look at it like that. Befriend it. Unless you befriend these things, they are tough to master. Then ultimately, nadi-shuddhi. Nadi-shuddhi. Shuddhi or shodhana? Shodhana or shuddhi? Nadi-shuddhi is same as manas-shuddhi. They are not two different things. By doing nadi-shuddhi, nadi-shodhana pranayama, the nervous system, sympathetic, parasympathetic, they get toned up, they get purified. The flow of energy in the body, the electrical energy, gets harmonized. And the mind becomes pure. Of course, body becomes pure.
But what is its function?
You inhale through one nostril and exhale through the other, and exhale, inhale again with the other and inhale through the other. So you will do it alternately. We will do it at the end. So I will be introducing all these things to you. It will take anywhere between 20 to 25 days. Then the meditation. Though I am using the word meditation as a part of the meditation, please note that all this is meditation only. Now means deha, asana, deha, prana, and manaha. Now we come to the mind. So, actual meditation, dhyanam it is. Though the entire thing is discipline of meditation, but still, in this you meditate upon a form, rupa, form of the Lord, etc. I'm not going to pursue that. Just I mentioned it is there. It can be done. People do that. But I'm not going to plan, I'm not going to introduce it. Because we have different forms. I love one form, you may love another form. There are any number of people who do not care for any given form. They are welcome to that also. So, Rupa Dhyanam is there, but I'm not going to emphasize it. B. Shabda. This we are going to do. Shabda means sound. Sound is a mantra. Mantra in the form of prayer. So, prayer with the help of Shabda, it will be there. We will do it. In appropriate prayer, I will introduce. In prayer's meaning also, we will reflect upon it. That is all part of the meditation. Then see. I am meditation. Being. Being.
To be,
yeah. Then conclusion. With prayer. Conclusion. That is also part of meditation. To conclude. Till you open the eyes, it is meditation only. Conclusion. So this is the scheme of meditation.
And Swami, we're going to do nidhidhyasana
type. This is all nidhidhyasana. That after Shabda is over, up to Shabda it is a dhyanam. Then I am being. That is nidhidhyasana. So A and B are dhyanam, C and D are nidhidhyasana.
being a meditator in the focus or the technique?
That is I am. That is I am. And that general attitude that is always there. That is an important point. The point is, the meditator is important, not the technique. Technique should subserve the meditator. Meditator should not subserve the technique. That is, not only in meditation, any system. The system should serve you. You should not serve the system. I mean, you serve the system all right, but ultimately, the system should serve you. That is the correct focus. So, I have a very lengthy scheme for meditation. In fact, I will be covering most of them every day. For example, first two are every day. They are there every day. And meditation and conclusion, one part of meditation and conclusion, they will be there every day. We will be alternating only between the middle ones. Prana things will be alternating. Prana vekshanam, I would like to do at least for this week, so that you can pursue it at home, in the room, and also when you go back. Prana vekshanam. In fact, prana vekshanam is such a thing, you can practice it any time during the day. So, this is the structure I have in mind for meditation. Okay.
This is a guided meditation, but all of this we should be able to...
Yeah, you will be. For prana vekshanam, whatever guidance I give for 2, 3, or 4 classes, that is more than enough for you. That will be just enough for you to pursue it. When it comes to, say, I am or being, etc., you may need guidance continuously. But for prana vekshanam, you don't need guidance after a point. So you will be able to practice it yourself.
And what do you mean by you need guidance?
I mean guided meditation type of environment you may not have, you need not have for prana vekshanam. Sometimes what happens is, a student may like to have the tape playing for meditation, which is okay, which is all right. You need not dispense with the tape. You can hold on to the tape and practice with the tape continuously.
My question, Swami, is can you do it without a tape?
Well, the prana vekshanam is like that. Prana vekshanam, you don't need tape.
But for rest, you...
For the rest, you may need, you may not need. It depends upon the individual. And you need not dispense with the tape. Not necessary. You can hold on to the tape. Don't look at the tape as a crutch. It is not. A guided meditation session, it is not that you are meditating and some support is always there. Is it okay? Don't have that kind of a doubt. It is okay. But for prana vikshanam, you don't need any guidance after a while. You will see it yourself. And you can practice it any time of the day. Whereas pranayama, you cannot practice any time of the day. Certain times of the day, when there is not a lot of food in the stomach, and you are not, after having a good lunch, etc., you can't do it. Some gap must be there between food and pranayama. But prana vekshanam, there is no such thing. You can practice any time of the day. So, you will see, this is the structure we will follow on these lines from tomorrow morning onwards. So I will be paying a lot of attention on asana and also on prana vikshana for a few days. For this week we will concentrate on that. Every day we will conclude with prayer and the conclusion part will be common every day. But from tomorrow asana and prana vikshana is the focus for some time. Next week we will introduce those sectional breathing and all that.
Will all this be part of one meditation session?
Not all. They alternate. The middle ones alternate. Prana things alternate. Depends upon the time also. But all of the things will be there by the end of the 1 month. You will have plenty of it. By 1 month, even 2 weeks, you will have plenty of it.
How does that help? You are observing the body part by part.
Yeah, you dissociate the identification from the body. By being witness to the body, you neutralize body identification. That is the only way to neutralize body identification, by being a neutral witness to the body. When you practice it for a while, then slowly the depth will come. That means you will develop a kind of distance, that within you will develop the distance with the body. That obsession with the body will get neutralized.
So you have to be that witness attitude.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Just observing or visualizing.
Just being identified with the body. In meditation, that is what everybody does. The non-Vedantic meditation, the meditator is identified with the body. And for him, technique is more important than the meditator. And for him, the body-identified person is a real entity. These are all wrong. We don't accept all that. Because this is Vedanta, you know, so this is not Hatha Yoga. Therefore, in Hatha Yoga, you won't have Deha Vikshanam. But some of the marvelous meditation techniques practiced all over India, all over the world, they have prana vikshanam. It's a very important thing. And so this is the basic structure that we will follow in meditation.